Welcome to Living Our Faith with Archbishop Jerome Listecki. The latest news, important issues, and stories of Catholics living their faith in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. Here's co-host Bob Bennis.
Broadcasting from the studios in the Cousins Center, the hub of the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, overlooking beautiful Lake Michigan.
Good morning and welcome. Let's say hello to the host of Living Our Faith, Archbishop Jerome Listecki. Good morning, Your Excellency.
Hi, Bob. How are you? Good.
I'm doing well. Today we're going to talk creed. We're going to talk the Nicene Creed,
yeah,
the Apostolic Creed.
Not Apollo Creed. No.
not the boxer Apollo creed.
Not the movie, right? We're talking about creed.
So maybe we call this kind of a Creed 101 class, say, a theologian's perspective,
yeah,
if you will.
Well, right. Or at least a believer's perspective, mm-hmm. You know, to articulate a little bit what our beliefs and why we constantly repeat that when we gather together, mm-hmm. in Mass on Sunday. You know, mm-hmm. the priest will, without fail, always kind of say, let us profess our faith.
Right, sure. Why don't you introduce our guest, if you would?
Sure. We're happy to have with us Father Kevin Barnekow. Kevin is currently at St. Alphonsus Parish in Greendale.
That's correct.
And you're there with a friend of your, Father Aaron Esch.
Father Aaron Esch, a good friend of mine.
They are very fortunate to have you two guys there.
Yeah, I'm very fortunate to have him as a pastor.
Right. Kevin is an ordained priest for the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. And Kevin, you studied in Belgium
at
Leuven. Tell us a little bit about that experience.
It was a really interesting experience, an opportunity to see Catholicism from across the world. A lot of students internationally were present studying theology, so an opportunity to really glean from a variety of perspectives, to challenge some of my perspectives, form them more solidly, and also to have a critical way of expressing them, hopefully in a world, so the world can hear what we say.
And on our program, Kevin, in order to, you don't mind me not saying Father Kevin,
that's
okay,
fine by
Kevin,
me.
Good. But in order to bring our listeners into a little bit more of a relationship with you, we usually ask our guests to tell us a little bit about your faith experience, what it was like growing up, you know, maybe your vocation when you decided to study for the priesthood. So please help us understand a little bit more about Kevin, okay?
I can do that. I grew up in West Allis. People ask me if I'm from Milwaukee, and I respond, I'm so from Milwaukee that I'm actually from West Allis. It was a real nice childhood. And my family were sort of normal Catholic people, and I often credit my mom with my vocation because she's the one who dragged us to Mass. Kids need to be dragged to Mass very often, and we weren't really the exception to that. And so we went to Mass on Sundays. They sent us, my parents, to St. Aloysius Catholic Grade School. Now it's Mary Queen of Saints Catholic Academy. And so we had a good Christian formation, a Catholic formation through elementary school, and then I was off to the public high school, and that was the place where I actually encountered something like my first awareness of my vocation, because of the people I was able to meet at the high school, friends of mine who were able to challenge my faith, not in a way that it was meant to shake it, but it actually, they challenged me by being such good Catholics and being able to express themselves so well and so comfortably as Catholics that it really made it possible for me to do the same. And it was in college, and I really began to study my mind toward the priesthood. Milwaukee School of Engineering, it was a great contrast experience, because when you're focused on mathematics and engineering principles, you recognize by way of exception that religion is often left out of that discussion, but it was something I was uncomfortable with, and so it began to promote in me a sort of a desire to explore it. My vocation,
sure.
More devotedly.
When was the kind of the pivotal moment when you said, "Yep, I'm going to do it. I'm going to take the challenge in the vocational call, and I'm going to study for the priesthood."
For me, I began thinking about it especially in college, but my pivotal time was in my first year of graduate school. I was studying at the University of Wisconsin for a master's degree in electrical engineering, and it just seemed that the in a way, the bloom was off the rose for engineering. It just lost its enchantment, mm-hmm. as I became more attracted by the possibility of priesthood. I actually became very discontented in my heart about what direction my life was taking. A very admirable direction. I wouldn't want to defame the profession. My dad's an engineer. My brother's an engineer. A lot of great engineering personalities who have really improved our world. But I knew that increasingly it wasn't for me. And that was the time when I had to take the step, and I began applying for the seminary. And I met people like other seminarians, actually, who were very important to me at the time and who are priests now.
And your mother was a catalyst, you said earlier.
Against her wishes, I think, because I'm not sure she was initially very happy about it. My mom, of course, was very happy to be a grandma. And I think when she saw me enter the seminary, it was one less opportunity to be a grandma. But no, and she's very supportive, of course, now, but it was really her example.
Sure.
And her example, if moms don't get as much credit as they deserve, but her example is what led my brothers to practice the faith so devoutly and devotedly. They're weekly mass goers, rosary prayers, confession goers. And that really is because of my mom's example. And my mom sort of led my dad back to the practice of the faith as well. So if she really... she either gets blame or credit for all of this, and I think I would give her credit.
So is it now Cardinal Dolan, then Archbishop Dolan, who asked you to study in Leuven?
Yeah, Archbishop Dolan asked me to study in Leuven. It was something that I wasn't exactly prepared to have that conversation. It wasn't exactly on my radar. He asked me about it, and it was something I had to really consider because it would involve me leaving everything I knew so well and loved, and all the reasons I became a priest are right here in Milwaukee, and then to go abroad was something that I'm very thankful for. It. I really now consider Belgium a second home to me. The people of Belgium were wonderful. The experiences that they afforded me were something I will never be able to forget, and I never would try to forget. I will always want to call them to mind. And so I'm very thankful for the opportunity that Archbishop Dolan offered me to send me there to study. It was a formational for priesthood, of course. That's what it was for, but I think it formed a lot more than just that. It formed me. Sure. I learned what it was like to be a pilgrim because I was living in a place that really wasn't my first home. And I had to know what it was like to be welcomed by others. I had to know what it was like to be a foreigner. I had to know what it was like to realize that our real destination then is in heaven. And this is a place where we can find a home here, but we're still sort of foreigners even here as our real homeland is in heaven.
And priesthood, are you loving it?
I love it. I have never had a day of regret.
Good.
I never regretted it for a single day. It can be a long day, a hard day, a tiring day, frustrating day.
Yeah,
frustrating
you
day.
You missed that word. I wanted to make sure you threw that one in.
And challenging, but I have never regretted it for a moment, even in its difficulties. It's something, if someone said, would you do it again? And I would unhesitatingly say yes. It's been so enriching, and I hope young men consider it for themselves.
Now, obviously, you can hear Bob, this young priest has a good head on his shoulder.
Exactly.
Know, his background. His
and education. The enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm. He loves, and also philosophy is a key element for
sure.
Him. He's a lover of basically the thought and the construction of thought and the impact. And we're talking about something which helps define us as a, not only as Catholics, certainly seminal for us Catholics, but for all of Christianity involved. I mean, we're going to be talking a little bit about the Nicene Creed. When I throw or somebody throws a Nicene Creed at you, Father Kevin, what do you think of when you think of the Nicene Creed?
I think of consubstantial.
There you go.
The real tough word.
Real tough word, yeah. I also think of the source of conflict that gave rise to it. I know there was a conflictual period that gave rise to the necessity of formulating a creed. So I think of how it's sort of important to the maintenance of a community.
I always take a look also at the creed as the real, if you want, almost like, and excuse me to use a little legal background, like the Marbury
versus Board of Education?
Judges. No, Marbury Madison, which helped to define the authority, literally, of the Supreme Court through a determination of whether or not these midnight judges, the appointment could be upheld. Of course, I look at the Nicene Creed a little bit in the affirmation of the church. Jesus establishes the church. He sends the Holy Spirit, and he empowers the church with the authority to make determination concerning basically the teaching and direction of the church. And it's the church fathers who come together in the early 300 in order to formulate what we now know is the Nicene Creed, because it's from the Council of Nicaea. So in terms of that, this is a real affirmation of the church. The church will define its authority in relationship to this as it continues to go forward. And, you know, I might say all of Christianity defines its relationship to basically the Nicene Creed, which will be found in all of our major churches. Mm-hmm. Major Protestant churches will adhere to the Nicene Creed from the Council of Nicaea.
It's critical. Also, the Council of Nicaea, the things that were considered were what constitutes communion in the church. So a relationship of a Christian believer to the Roman bishop, the Pope, the Bishop of Alexandria, the Bishop of Antioch, those were hallmarks of what we would call orthodoxy or Catholic truth. And so what was at stake at Nicaea was the church's own understanding of herself as constituted by Christ to share in his authority.
And for we as Catholics, it is the Nicene Creed is so important that if you take a look at what I'm sure, you know, many people in history will refer to one of the great achievements of now St. John Paul II, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. You will find immediately that in the very first formulations of what the Church believes, you will find the articulation of the Nicene Creed.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Nicene Creed, which basically is then in the Catechism broken down into various aspects and responded to as the tenets of our faith.
We have a tendency, I think, at times to sit in the pews and just speak and read the profession of our faith rather than really, as we say it, digging in mentally to what am I really professing here? What am I really saying?
There's a Latin phrase. It's a wonderful phrase. Lex orandi, lex credendi. We pray what we believe. And so when actually people are praying or saying the prayers, inherent in those prayers are a testimony of our faith, mm-hmm. are the truths and the doctrines and the teaching. That I often joke with kids when it comes down to and say, well, what's the first prayer you learned? Oh, the Hail Mary. Oh, the Our Father. You know, back and forth. Oh, now I lay me down to sleep. You know, they'll go into all this. No, the very first prayer you learned was in the name of the Father and of the Son and of mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit. And in that, you are articulating who God is. He is Father, He is Son, and He is Holy Spirit. Three persons in one God. You are articulating the Trinity.
Very good. Thank you. We're going to unpack this a lot more when we come on the other side of the break, but we'll take a break now. You'll hear a commercial message, then we'll go to the news from our friends at the Catholic Herald. You're listening to Living Our Faith here on Relevant Radio for Southeast Wisconsin.
Many of us at some point in our lives must face a decision regarding how we can best be cared for when rehabilitation is necessary following surgery or a medical crisis. Hear from St. Camilla's Nursing Administrator Sandra Dugan regarding the exceptional rehabilitation program at St. Camilla's.
What makes St. Camilla's rehab unique and special as it compares to our competitors is that we are the only continuum of care campus in the area that offers skilled nursing, home health, and outpatient services. You will get consistent staff throughout your rehab journey, and there's excellent communication throughout the continuum in order to promote maximum outcomes. They also can continue with the home care therapists that they have already come to know and trust in their own home when they're discharged from our facility.
For more information regarding St. Camilla's rehabilitation, go to relevantradio.com keyword rehab. That's keyword rehab.
Good morning, I'm Grace David with headlines from this week's Catholic Herald and CatholicHerald.org. The Catholic Community Foundation has a question for the 200 parishes in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. If you had a wish and we could fulfill it with $15,000, what would it be? Said Ann Rieger, a CCF board member. The best five answers are worth $15,000 each to the parishes whose wishes are granted. We don't want this to be a burden. We want this to be a fun contest, said Mary Ellen Markowski, president of the foundation. We want to build awareness of the Catholic Community Foundation, but we also want the parish communities to have fun with this. CCF is sponsoring the contest in celebration of its 15th anniversary and to create awareness of its work. According to Rieger, the awareness building is an important part of the program. We're providing an incentive for parishes to spread the word about the Catholic Community Foundation, she said. Father Dan Janicek, a CCF board member and pastor of St. Leonard Muskego, added, "What better way to spread the word about the Catholic Community Foundation?" Noting the demands pastors face when it comes to money, Father Janicek said this is an opportunity for parishes to dream big. Be creative and imaginative with this, he said. It's not just the pastor doing this, it's the parish doing this. Noting the maximum number of entries vying for the 5 awards is 200, Father Janicek laughingly said, the odds are slightly better than winning the Powerball. The contest is open only to parishes. For details, see this week's Catholic Herald, catholicherald.org, or call 414-431-6402. That's 414-431-6402. There is much more to read in this week's Catholic Herald, including how a group of women at St. Anne Pleasant Prairie has become a strong spiritual presence to their parish and to each other, one couple's journey to adopting triplets whose mother had planned to abort them, the faith and commitment at the heart of religious education for children and adults with special needs, and finally, a tribute to St. Joseph the Worker that will make you smile and appreciate the gift of work. Remember, updates of Catholic news and information appear regularly at the newly redesigned website, CatholicHerald.org. We hope you'll visit us regularly. This is Grace David reminding you I'll be back in 2 weeks with more headlines from the Catholic Herald and CatholicHerald.org. Until then, thank you for listening. We now return you to Living Our Faith with Archbishop Listecki.
Welcome back to Living Our Faith here on Relevant Radio. Our guest today is Father Kevin Barnekow, and we are unwrapping the Nicene Creed and kind of getting a theologian's perspective to it. And Father, pick up where you left. We were talking during the break, and you took us back to the Roman Empire. Can you expand on that a little bit?
Well, I can. Part of the reason for the conflict as mm-hmm. it developed was because Constantine the Great won the imperial crown and then officially tolerated Christianity in 315. And when that happened, the kind of conflicts that would have been a part of Christianity, an opportunity to be expressed publicly, the things that would have been dividing actually came to the surface. And so as a consequence, those divisions had to be resolved. They actually threatened, in Constantine's judgment, the unity of the empire. And so the council that was called was called to respond to a particular claim that was made that denied the divinity of Christ, didn't accept that Christ is God, true God, and true man. And that's what we call Arianism. And it's after the priest, unfortunately, Arius, who proposed it.
You take a look at the history of the Catholic Church throughout the ages. Oftentimes, many of the churches that developed, that broke off because of the direction of leaders, oftentimes priests.
Yes,
absolutely. Yeah.
Who did that. And here we have no exception about someone who's directing individuals to think that that Jesus Christ was not, couldn't fathom his divinity, accepted a wonderful Jesus as a human being and a human figure, but not necessarily divine. Kevin, when we take a look at it, we profess the creed every Sunday. And I know for a lot of people, they believe it's like a hiccup in the Mass. You know? So all of a sudden, we stop and we're seeing all these doctrinal propositions. You know, what's a good way for Catholics to be able to appreciate what they're doing at that time?
Part of what it means to be a Christian is to identify ourselves as Christians, especially by how we act in the world, but to come together and to recognize ourselves as the church founded by Christ, members of his mystical body, to offer him worship. Also, we're called to recognize those things that we hold in common as Christians, the things that really distinguish us from other believers of other sorts. And that's not to say that we should enjoy division, but we should enjoy the unity to which God calls us. And that's also expressed in the creed.
Now, before we take a look at the Nicene Creed, a lot of people will be saying, well, what about this other thing they say usually at the Rosary, the Apostles' Creed?
Yeah.
What is that, Father Kevin? What is
that? One of the functions of the Apostles' Creed is, particularly if you've been to a baptism recently, or if you've been to a baptism at Mass, the Apostles' Creed is what is meant to direct a baptismal faith. It's meant to, parents will profess that on behalf of their children, or adults who will be baptized profess oftentimes the Apostles' Creed. It's it functions to initiate us into the life of the church. Nicene Creed is for those of us who've been initiated to manifest our faith.
But you know, a lot of us will get confused because we start them almost in the same way. You know,
yeah.
I believe
guilty.
In,
I've done that.
Yeah, I'm actually guilty of that too.
So we understand that it is. But how are focusing on the Nicene Creed, that definitional aspect and identity with basically all Christianity? Let's take a look at it. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and of all that is seen and unseen. How important that seen and unseen of
absolutely,
God
who's
a Creator.
Yeah, I think even the most, in a sense, subversive line is I believe in one God, and that means I can't be that God, and that means my projects can't replace God's projects. He's the creator of all things seen and unseen, and so I become then an adorer of God when I make that statement.
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one in being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. Now, in the aspect consubstantial with the Father, mm-hmm. you said, you said that. You always kind of think of it, and every theologian has to grapple with that. What's so significant about that consubstantial with the Father?
That was like the great fight, actually, if I may say, fight at the Council of Nicaea, how to express the relationship of Christ to the Father, how to express their unity. And the word they sort of settled on is a word that's sort of difficult for us. Consubstantial means they share the same divinity, the same deity, even though they're distinct. This is you have to use this word, as to their persons, the Father and the Son share the same deity, the same divine nature. And the word consubstantial is meant to represent that mystery.
And they're one from, we're creatures of time, from the very beginning, they're one till the end of time. So there is no time. They are all one. Lovers understand that,
yes,
I think.
Yes.
You know, sorry to do this romantic thing type of thing, but you know, but for those of you listening, but lovers understand that. They, when they understand the person that they love, they feel that there is no space, there is no time. They feel caught into the truth of their love. And in a real sense, the Trinity is the love of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit that has no sense, basically, of time, that is always an eternal act, that's always an eternal now. Even when we talk about the life yet to come, our hope is to become one in the Trinity, to become one before this Trinity of persons, to be pulled in ultimately to that great love. And, you know, when someone really, truly loves, they don't care about anything else.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing else they ever have to worry about. And here, this second person of that Trinity comes down and becomes one with us through the power of the Holy Spirit and the fiat of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mary who says yes to basically God's hand. So this person of the Trinity, this person that Father Kevin was talking about in terms of the divine aspect, now in obedience to the Father to fulfill his will becomes man with us.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes on to say, for our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scripture. So a definite statement of the Paschal mystery of the suffering, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus, which forms the Catholic faith life.
Absolutely. I think one of the critical understandings of that was historically. That happened in the earth, in history. Christians make a claim to history. It's not some kind of myth that we're talking about. It's something that happened. It took place in our time and in our history, and I think that's a critical piece that sometimes we forget just how revolutionary that is in the notion of religion. It's you can't do without history if you're a Christian.
And we follow the entire focus and relationship of Jesus, because on the third day he rose again
mm-hmm.
in fulfillment of the Scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. So the fulfillment of the promise of Jesus, in terms of the aspect that he sits at the right hand of the Father to judge the living and the dead. So our response of our lives given over to Jesus is one that will be held accountable. And then the Nicene Creed ends with, we believe in the Holy Spirit. So Jesus mm-hmm. promises the Advocate. Holy Spirit is sent basically his church, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. So they are all together. They are together in the divine nature. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church, the four marks of the church, which is a wonderful aspect to take a look at, basically the church, true church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Nicene Creed. It's a wonderful aspect immediately of understanding the importance of our definition. And every one of those little phrases that I said, you can spend a lifetime and have dissertations upon dissertations examining, right,
Father? Absolutely. That's what the Catechism itself attempts to do, for at least for broadly speaking.
And if one really wants to begin to take a look and to parse all of that Nicene Creed, you'll find the part one of the first of the four parts of the Catechism, part one devoted, devoted entirely to basically the Nicene Creed.
And I look at it, and what really jumps out to me is at the very beginning, all things visible and invisible. Ladies and gentlemen, there are things here that you won't see. They're invisible. Then you go down, who has spoken through the prophets? You go back to Old Testament. He's spoken to us back then. And then we finish, and if we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church, we will look forward, should look forward, to the to our resurrection and the life of the world to come.
St. Augustine said, in the Old Testament, the New Testament is concealed. Mm-hmm. In the New Testament, the Old Testament is revealed.
Very good. Father Kevin Barnekow, this time went so fast, I think we need to have you back, and then we'll go over the Apostles' Creed, and we'll talk about the 12 precepts there, and then that half hour will race by, too.
Yeah, what a wonderful idea.
We're going to take our second break with a reminder that everything you need to know about what is happening right here in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee can be found at the website, archmil.org. We'll be right back to Living Our Faith here on Relevant Radio.
A trip to the hospital can be an intimidating event for patients and their families. Oftentimes, a hospitalization will require rehabilitation after discharge. The way this transition is handled is critical to the health and well-being of your loved one. St. Camillus Rehabilitation maintains a standard of excellence, and our record proves it. 99% of our discharged patients return to functioning at the same level or higher prior to their rehab stay, and the average length of stay is just 24 days. Satisfied patients is evidenced by our post-discharge satisfaction surveys, which average a 4.5 out of a 5-star rating. Hear about the St. Camillus mission from Nursing Administrator Sandra Dugan.
We strive to practice the St. Camillus mission by providing holistic care, and this can be assured through physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual care needs that we will meet in our continuum of care and in all phases of life.
For more information regarding St. Camillus Rehabilitation, go to relevantradio.com, keyword rehab.
We'd like to thank our guest today, Father Kevin Barnekow, for joining us. And as we go forward with our day, we do as we always do on Living Our Faith. We close the show in prayer. Your Excellency?
Sure, and I would ask Father Kevin if he would lead us, especially in this year of mercy, the Pope's prayer for the year of mercy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us to be merciful like the Heavenly Father, and have told us that whoever sees you sees him. Let the Church be your visible face in the world. Send your Spirit so that the Jubilee of Mercy may be a year of grace from the Lord, and your Church, with renewed enthusiasm, bring good news to the poor, proclaim liberty to captives and the oppressed, and restore sight to the blind. We ask this through the intercession of Mary, Mother of Mercy, you who live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for joining us today. Have a wonderful weekend. And together, let's be transformed by the Spirit.
This has been Living Our Faith with Archbishop Jerome Listecki and co-host Bob Bennis. Join us again next week for the latest news, important issues, and stories of Catholics living their faith in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. Faith in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. Faith in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. Faith in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee.